titled this Unraveling, the Spalding Book of Mormon Authorship Hypothesis. It's also known as the Spalding-Rigdon Theory. And I Paper Whisperer is my online moniker, posting name. Okay, an outline, we're going to review who is Solomon Spalding. What is the Spalding-Rigdon Theory? When did it first appear? It's an old theory. It's been around since formation of Mormonism. Okay, what's the basis for the theory? What's the evidence? What are the recent developments, if any? And what's about the surviving Spalding manuscript? We'll talk about that more. There is one Spalding manuscript that is extant. And we'll talk about what the pro-Mormon response is to some degree. I want to make it clear that I'm not really advancing the theory. I'll be taking an advocacy position as I present this video or this presentation, but I'm not really trying to advance that theory. There are other possibilities. I'm just doing a formative examination of the evidence. It won't be a balanced discussion of alternative authorships. I won't be talking about the official church history, nor will I be talking about the Joseph Smith, the sole author, alternative theory. It'll be a limited discussion. There's a lot of detail that we have to cover when you talk about the Spalding theory. I'll try to cover as much detail as possible. However, the time simply won't allow us to cover all the information, so I'll be skipping over some of the information. Specifically, I won't be talking about the possibility of Oliver Cowdery's role in the conspiracy. It's been suggested by some authors that he was involved, but the evidence is rather minimal on that, and I'm not going to cover that at all. And my disclaimer, I'm not a historian by profession. I don't proclaim to be an expert. I haven't done any original research on the Spalding theory. All my research has been on people that have published and posted online. First primary source that I've used is Who Really Wrote the Book of Mormon? The Spalding Enigma, published in 2005. Unless otherwise noted, this is my primary source. However, it's not my only source. Another source is Sidney Rigdon, Creating the Book of Mormon by Craig Criddle. This is found online at that website. And he has posted a lot of information. And I'll be addressing some of his information in the later slides. Early American Influences on the Book of Mormon and Book of Mormon Tories by Tom Donofrio. Is that the correct pronunciation? And finally, I should mention Dale Broadhurst in passing, because he has done a lot of original research that these other authors have depended upon. Okay, Solomon Spalding. He was born in 1761 in Connecticut, died in 1816. That would have been at age 55, so he died fairly young. And would have been about when Joseph Smith was 10 years old, so they didn't overlap. He was a Revolutionary War vet. He was a private in the Army. He had a Master of Arts degree from Dartmouth College in Divinity, and Ethan Smith, the author of View of the Hebrews, was his roommate while at college. Go ahead.
Did you not use B.H. Roberts at all?
Yes, I've read B.H. Roberts, but I'm not using it in the presentation. Solomon was a lapsed preacher. He was a failed businessman and a failed real estate speculator. And he moved to Conneaut, Ohio in 1809. He lived there for a couple of years, till 1812. And he was, we're still having problems with this mic system. I keep fading in and out. I'm trying, we're recording this, so I'll need the amplification. Anyway, he moved to Conneaut, Ohio in 1809. He has some real estate investments up there in the Western Reserve. And he also started a business there, a forge, but he was injured, so there was a personal injury, so he went to writing, and he always, he did writing on a personal level. He just enjoyed doing it, and he tried to turn that later into a business interest. Can you still hear me okay? Okay, let me back up. Thank you. So he was a would-be author of a prehistoric American epic history explaining the origins of the mound builders, which descended from the lost 10 tribes of Israel. And he frequently shared this developing story with his family, his friends, and his neighbors. And it's from those witnesses that we know of this. Between 1812 and 1816, he first resided in Pittsburgh, and then he went to Amity, Pennsylvania. And while he was there in Pittsburgh, he submitted the publication to a publishing firm for publication, but it was never published because it was on hold pending financial backing. He never could raise the backing. Just to give you an idea, I kind of like to get a picture to see where these places are. So here's Kirtland in green, and Conneaut is right up in the northeast corner of the state of Ohio, right next to the state of Pennsylvania. And when he moved to Amity, it's about 40 miles south of Pittsburgh, right down here. And he kept moving to find cheaper living conditions because he was really not financially very well off. Anyway, he submitted his publication to the Pittsburgh publishing firm, R&J Patterson's bookstore and publishing firm. And again, it was an epic story of the mound builders. And it was never published. Now, this is the theory. This is what's being suggested. Sidney Rigdon acquired the manuscript and incorporated Campbellism theology in his own personal theology, where he disagreed with Campbell. He was associated with the Pittsburgh printing firm at that time. He surreptitiously acquired the manuscript from the printing firm, and he later added theology after Spalding's death.